minta maaf lah kena terpaksa buat kelas petang sebab pagi semalam saya ada meeting, jadi saya tak boleh nak buat kelas. Meeting saya pukul 9 ni, omnya kelas pukul 8 pukul 10. Okay, alright. Sebenarnya saya lebih suka kalau for today we do more relax kelas-kelas sebab hari ni pun hari Sabtu petang pula tu kan, semua pun dengan tu ke atau lapar ke ataupun dia nak pergi jalan dia tak dapat pergi jalan, sorry lah ya. Apa ni, tapi siapa yang dekat nilai tak boleh pergi jalan lah kan, duduk kat rumah je kan. Siapa yang kat kampung lah boleh bergerak. Okay, macam sebagai as I mentioned to Syami, saya kata hari ni saya nak buat a little bit of work with regards to charges. Okay, that's why I asked you since you have recently belajar tentang charges dengan Datuk semalam kan? Okay. And another one is section 51A. Section 51A dah go through kan? Discovery. Document, delivery of documents.
Rasa belum kan?
Korang. Section 51A SPC.
Belum.
Belum lagi?
Belum.
Okay, alright. Okay, sebab satu tu lima, sebab saya takkan go to through everything. I akan fokus only on 51A. 51A ni tak panjang, pendek aje. Cuma 51A is so practical. Dia memang so, totally practical. Benda yang kita practice day in day out when we do trial. Okay, charges pun sama. Okay, alright. But I think we start with charges. Since you all just recently, betul-betul recently studied, had a lecture about charges. What do you understand is the purpose of a charge?
To let the court know.
Okay.
What case are about, is about. Mm-hmm. And let the accused himself know what happened. Mm-hmm. And give the opportunity for him mm-hmm. to prepare for defense.
Mm-hmm. Okay, that's right. Generally, that is what the purpose is about lah. First, to let people in the court, including the bench, including the defense, to know what the charge is all about, and particularly for the defense to prepare for their defense. Basically. So that is the main purpose of a charge. All right. So that's why, because the charge is to inform everybody, everybody about what the case is all about, generally what the case is all about. So that is why a charge has to be precise, has to be certain, has to be clear. Okay. So basically, I'm not going to go through the law on charges because you've already gone through it. But what you have to do when you are preparing a charge, this one, okay, for this, when you talk about charges, it is in particularly very important for the prosecutor. Okay, because it's the prosecutor who will be preparing the charges. All right. So in particular, prosecutor has a very high duty of making sure that the charge or the charges are correct, precise, can be understood, right? So for the defense, when you received a charge, what do you normally do first when you receive a charge? I mean, your client has been charged in court. You receive the charge. What do you do first? What do you think? For the defense, what should you do first when you look at the charge?
Analyze the charge and what punishment and anything that can be adjust or I mean apa-apa yang boleh dibetulkan ke
for the defense.
I mean charge tu betul tak? Charge tu betul tak boleh dikenakan?
I see. Okay. Any other suggestion? When you receive as defense lawyer, what do you do when you receive the charge? What do you what should you do first? What do you think you should do first when you receive the charge?
Kita kena analyse the facts, which is whether it is suitable for the charge or not.
Okay, you analyse the charge, alright. Okay, when you analyse the charge, what do you look? What are you looking for? What would be the first thing that you look for?
The offence.
The offence, alright. The first thing that you look for is what the offence is about. Look at the charge. The first thing you look at is the offence. Because once you gather what the offence is, then you will know what is required under the law. Okay? So you will know what is required under the law. For example, if the charge is for a charge of rape. Okay? You look at it. Okay, section 376 of the Penal Code, for example. So you straight away know, okay, this is a charge of rape. As defense counsel, the things that you will be looking at is, okay, once you know the offense, the next thing that you will do is you look at the elements of the charge. Okay, you look at the elements of the charge. All right. For certain offenses, the name of the charge, for example, rape, murder, has to be clearly spelled out in the charge. Okay? Like murder. Telah membunuh. Contoh, eh? Ataupun kalau manslaughter. Menyebabkan kematian. Dia tak boleh panggil membunuh. Eh? Sebab membunuh is for murder. Manslaughter telah menyebabkan kematian. Right? So, you look at that. Alright? That is one thing. Next, you know, for example, if it's murder or if it's rape, you know where to look for the elements of the charge. Because rape, dia ada beza-beza, ya. The offense is one, rape. But if it involves different types of victim, okay? For example, if it involves a normal adult, okay, normal adult, then you know what the elements are. If it involves children below the age of 16, right? So you will know what the elements are. Similar, if you're looking at murder, right? You know what the elements are. Of course, the general thing about mens rea, actus reus, those are the general principles. But each elements of the charge. So once you have already received the charge, you know what the offense is about, then you will know what the elements of the charge are. Okay? All right. That is if one charge has been preferred. What if there are several other charges? Let's say same accused, all right, charge for similar offense, but different time. Same accused, charged for similar offense, but different time. We're just talking here about general, right? We're not specific. Can it be done?
Yes.
Boleh, madam. Tapi time to exact.
Time to
sebutkan.
Okay, maksudnya?
Maksudnya silapkan bila, pada tarikh bila, mm-hmm, dan yang lain tu bila kena, mm-hmm, dispesifikan.
Okay, you all tahu tak the concept of I'm sure Datuk dah explain to you about joint charges, joint trial.
Belum.
Belum lagi, madam.
Oh, belum lagi. Okay.
Within 12 months.
Sorry?
Within 12 months.
Ah, within 12 months. Yeah, who said that? Shauki, eh? Saya dengar suara je, tapi saya tak nampak orang.
Free hair.
Okay, within 12 months. Okay, alright. If it's for the same accused, within a span of 12 months, he can be tried with how many charges?
Three.
Siapa jawab tu?
Saya.
Saya. Okay. Luqman lah.
Yeah.
Ah, okay. Three. Alright. Because ada provision specific. Dia kata kat situ ya. Alright. That you can. Alright. If it involves the same accused. Okay. Sekarang saya nak tanya. Itu joint charges ke atau itu joint trial?
Joint trial.
Joint trial. Betul. Joint trial. Eh? Joint charges lain. Eh? Joint trial. Sebab dia ada perbicaraan. Sepatutnya satu perbicaraan, satu charge kan? I mean the general principle is one charge, one trial. Correct? Okay. One charge, one trial. Of course, but there are exceptions. Okay. Exceptions as per under the law. Antaranya itulah. Alright. You can join three trials committed by the same accused, basically, within a span of 12 months. Okay, tu contoh. However, if it's a corruption case, it's a case under SPRM, Akta Suruhanjaya Pencegahan Rasuah Malaysia. If it involves the same accused yang sama, okay, even if the offence committed within a span of 12 months, mungkin dia beza dalam 2 tahun, 3 tahun macam tu, can still be charged jointly. So because dalam peruntukan akta tersebut, akta SPRM, it's stated like that. Okay, so the general rule says that within a span of 12 months, but at the same time, you still have to look at the specific law. For example, SPRM, Akta SPRM. As long as it involves the same accused, regardless of when the offence was committed, he or she can be tried jointly. Okay? The charges can be tried jointly. Right? Yes, maksudkan. Okay? Alright. So, maknanya sekarang ni boleh join trial, boleh join charge. Alright. Sekarang ni join charges. Who can actually tell me what joint charges mean?
Maksudnya, the offender, the criminal is committing more than one offense in one particular time. Contoh macam rape. The offense is trespassing into somebody's house. And also he's raping and maybe he's apa dia mencuri juga ke
so basically there are two offenses there. You're saying there are two offenses, contohnya theft, and then dia at the same time they rape the girl. Okay, during ini is that joint charge? Is that a joint charge or is that a joint trial?
Honestly, I cannot still cannot see the difference. But since if the same offender is committing different offenses in one particular time, it is at the same time, the charges can be combined.
Charges combined. Okay. I'm trying to understand what you were saying. You are saying that, for example, the example that you gave me just now, you commit the theft and rape. Is that right?
Yes.
Is that right? Okay. Yes. Commit the theft and rape, and he can be charged for rape and also for theft, right?
Yes.
Okay. Okay. So is that joint trial or is that joint charge?
Joint trial.
I'm not sure.
Baru belajar semalam, macam mana ni?
Madam nak try.
Nak tahu dengan pening kepala ni.
Madam nak try.
Joint trial ke joint charge?
Joint trial.
Joint trial. Okay. Okay, so joint charge macam mana pula ni?
Madam, dia sepatutnya separate charge kan?
Ah yes, tadi macam tadi separate charge. One theft is one charge.
Yes.
Rape is one charge. So this that is actually two separate charges. So with two separate charges, it will be a joint trial.
This separate charge, joint trial lah.
Joint trial, yes, correct. Now it's joint charges. Now macam mana pula joint charge?
Saya rasa joint charges kalau charge dia tu macam...
Kuat sikit Husna, tak berapa dengar.
Saya rasa joint charge tu dia untuk apa offense yang tak begitu distinct macam theft dengan rape. Tapi dia maybe macam, saya tak sure contoh saya betul tak, maybe macam pecah rumah, rompak dan curi. Macam tu kot.
Sorry?
So dia boleh jadi... So dia boleh jadi dalam satu charge.
Rompak dan
pecah rumah. Tu contoh rompak. Saya reka sendiri. I don't know.
Rompak. Okay. Rompak is robbery. Alright. Pecah rumah is house trespass.
Rompak dan curi. Robbery and theft.
Robbery and theft are two different charges, Sam. Two different charges.
Charges yang connected, madam. Yang macam lebih kurang.
Yang macam lebih kurang. Okay. You have to understand. Okay. Charges untuk offense. I mean, we're talking about offense, alright? Offenses, as long as it falls, okay, to the easiest way lah for you to understand, as long as the charge falls under different section of the law, it is a separate charge. Okay, walaupun we're talking about robbery, we're talking about theft, kan? But it normally falls under different provision of the law. For example, 381, that's for robbery. 379, that's for theft. Okay? So, when it falls under different provisions of the law, it is a distinct offense. Mm-hmm. Each distinct offense to be tried separately, right? Okay. Now what I'm asking is once it's distinct offense, so it will be tried separately. Okay. So now when you want to combine those separate charges, it will be a joint charge. Boleh ke?
Joint trial.
Okay. Macam ni lah. Okay. Kita put dalam layman's term. Satu offense rape, satu offense theft, satu offense housebreaking. Tiga. Dilakukan dalam satu masa yang sama. Yalah, dia housebreak into a person's house and then commit. Okay lah, dengan theft lah. Theft ni lain sikit. Sebab kalau once dah masuk dalam rumah, it's robbery lah. They commit robbery. And third, they rape the girl inside the house. Okay. So each one is actually a separate offense. Okay. Satu is housebreaking. Second is robbery. Third is rape. Okay. So bila dah ada tiga charge macam ni, committed by the same person, right? Committed by the same person, and you want the trial to be heard together, okay? Sebab dia so close together, so connected to each other, yeah? To form the same transaction. Ni nanti kan ada lagi pening kepala, tak apa. But these three can be tried together. When the court allows these three offenses to be tried together, it is called a joint trial. Okay, joint trial. Okay, so far faham eh yang ni? I mean, I've tried to put it as simple as I can lah. So it's a joint trial because setiap satu tu offense tu masih berbeza. Tak sama. Boleh ya? Okay ya?
Boleh.
Okay, alright. Okay. Joint charge, for example, joint charge, okay. Contohnya, dua orang. Okay, dua orang dia commit theft. Okay, Okay, dia ambil harta yang sama. Dua orang masuk dalam rumah tu, dia okay, bukan telah rompak, dia robbery. Dia masuk dalam rumah tu, dia, yang ni kumpul barang dekat dapur, yang ni kumpul barang dekat dalam bilik, yang ni kumpul barang dekat ruang tamu, and then dia flat. Okay. Bila kena tangkap, dua-dua kena tangkap with all the things. Alright. So bila you charge dia, do you charge dia separately atau you charge dia bersama?
Bersama.
Bersama. Yes, you charge dia bersama. One thing, one, because you tak tahu yang siapa yang ambil. So katalah barang yang dia bawa tu, handphone, laptop, apa semua. You don't know siapa yang curi kan? Kan? Ha, cuma mungkin kita ada evidence mengatakan maybe tuan rumah tu kata dia nampak, tuan rumah tu kata dua orang datang, tie them up and then ambil dia punya laptop and things like that. Itu je. So now bila kena tangkap, dua-dua ada, dan this is the simple scenario lah. Bila polis tangkap, dua-dua ada. Barang pun ada semua. So when you charge separately ke? Macam yang tadi cakap, no, we charge together, betul? Okay. Committed robbery for both. Itu adalah joint
charge.
Joint charge. Okay. Alright. Saya tak pastilah saya punya lecture notes ni boleh bagi clearer picture ke tidak, sebab saya rasa sama je. Alright. I'll try to okay. Join trials. Okay. Joint charge ni kadang-kadang kita panggil joinder of offences juga. Which means that the offender is charged together. Okay? Alright. So, why do we need to have this difference? Kenapa kita kena bezakan antara joint charge dengan joint trial?
Sebab dia adalah exception kepada general rule.
Okay, yes, it's an exception to the general rule. What is the general rule?
Separate
charges for distinct offenses. Separate charges for distinct offenses. Alright, so that's the general rule lah. So yang lain-lain tu semua is
bagi nama muka
tu. Yang lain-lain tu semua is basically an exception to the general rule. Okay. Okay. Another thing, why is it important that we have to separate? We have to distinguish between joint charge and joint trial. Okay. Why? Because one thing, misjoinder will cause apa? Misjoinder of accused person amounts to what? Misjoinder of accused person amounts to what?
Amounts to discharge of the charge, amount to miscarriage of justice, and apa lagi ya?
Betul, and dia punya effect tu betul. Because misjoinder of accused persons will amount to illegality. Okay, illegality means kalau if the proceeding proceeded, it would be illegal lah. Illegal maknanya tidak sah lah. So boleh, akibatnya boleh, the accused person can be discharged, boleh dibebaskan. So that's why we have to be very very careful when we charge somebody and when we apply for it to be charged, to be jointly charged ataupun tried jointly. Okay. Memang confused sebab you all tak tak nampak in the sense of practice. Okay, but once you practice, you will see it. Baru kita boleh nampak. Alright, practical, in fact, preparing the charge itself pun, selagi kita tak ada fakta depan mata, we will not be able to prepare a proper charge. Okay, so I will not go into depth about charges because you are actually you memang belajar lah kan, baru belajar kan, alright. But along the way, if you have any question that you do not understand, just ask, okay. But saya pun tak mau nanti ada tak mau konflik lah, takut ada saya ajar yang tak betul ke apa ke. I don't think so lah. We normally we don't teach benda yang tak betul lah. Cuma mungkin practically cara praktisnya kadang-kadang berbeza. Alright. But whatever it is, the law is clear. Huh? The law about charges, joinder of trial, joint charges, joint trial ni, it's very clear. Alright. So since charge is actually something yang you really have to grab, something you really kena concentrate on when you wanted to start a proceeding ataupun as a defense counsel. Alright, so macam as a defense counsel, you look at the charge, what was it about? Okay, you know the elements of the charge, alright? So once you know the elements of the charge, what are you looking at? Okay. Alright. Another thing, apart from all this procedure, charges juga, pertuduhan juga has to be worded clearly. Clearly and sometimes precise. Okay? Sometimes precise. Contohnya, macam dalam kes dadah, you have to be precise at the weight of the drugs. Why? Why? Because sometimes you want to use the presumption under the law. Presumptions under the Dangerous Drugs Act, dia ada yang melibatkan berat, weight of the drug. So if you want to refer to, you want to use the presumptions under the Dangerous Drugs Act, you have to make sure that the weight of the drugs are correct. Okay, so be precise. Some other things, for example, rape, because rape dia, it is an offence which has a name. There are a few provisions, there are a few offences where they call it, they say that the offence, the name of the offence, for example, rape, name of the offence, murder, it's the name of the offence. Okay, that's why kalau you tengok kes-kes yang, kalau kita dengar kes-kes bunuh tu, memang dia sebut perkataan telah membunuh siapa. Okay. Dan kalau yang manslaughter, telah menyebabkan kematian siapa. They follow the wordings of the act. As much possible, you have to follow the wordings of the act. Sebaik mungkin kena ikut wordings of the act. Alright? Okay. One thing, petani saya tak nak bagi lecture sangat, saya nak tanya banyak. Sekarang ni saya nak tanya. Katalah, senang bagi contoh case rate lah ya. Accused raped the same girl, okay, the same girl, angsa yang sama ya, pukul 3 pagi, pukul 6 pagi, pukul 8 pagi, okay, accused yang sama, okay, victim pun sama, alright. So sekarang bolehkah kita can we charge the accused with just one charge of rape? Okay. Dengan 3 waktu yang berbeza. Ataupun you have to charge pukul 3 satu, pukul 6 satu, pukul 8 satu.
Satu.
Kena berbeza.
Berbeza. 3.
Kenapa berbeza?
Sebab 3 kali.
Sorry? Kuat sikit.
Sebab benda tu 3 kali and boleh jadi one of the time tu rape tak dikomit pun. So I mean kena determine satu-satu.
Kena determine satu-satu. Okay. Yang lain siapa lagi kata kena satu-satu-satu?
One charge for one offences only.
Mm-hmm. Maksudnya? Bukan sebab sekarang ni victim dia sama je.
Saya rasa macam gabung je satu charge. Tapi mm-hmm. dalam fact tu cakap rogol tu berlaku dalam tiga kali pada tiga masa.
Okey, satu pertuduhan terhadap A, terhadap Ali telah merogol Ayu pada pukul 3, 6 dan 8 pagi. Macam tu.
Ha.
Okey.
Sebab setahu saya kalau kes rogol ni dia detail dia lain macam ah.
Detail maksudnya?
Dia detail lah berlaku. Contoh pada pukul 8 pelakuan dia macam mana? Yang petang aha. ni yang pelakuan dia macam mana?
Aha.
Biasanya so, tapi, saya pernah baca lah.
Aha, tapi tadi you cakap dia still but you're saying that still satu charge cuma satu pertuduhan Ali telah merogol kamu Ali telah merogol Ayu pada pukul 8 pukul 3 pukul 6 pukul 8 telah merogol Ayu macam tu. Is it?
Ya.
Okay. Alright. Okay. Yang lain?
Saya sokong yang Ashraf tadi.
Okay. Alright. Atas alasan?
Sebab atas alasan satu sebab dia melakukan satu offense lah. Tapi satu offense saja. Tiga waktu yang berbeza. Jadi kita boleh gabungkan tu dalam satu fakta. Mm-hmm. Tapi bawah satu pertuduhan yang sama.
Mm-hmm. Okay. Siapa lagi yang ada pendapat? Sama ada boleh buat satu untuk tiga masa yang berbeza ataupun satu charge. Setiap satu tu satu charge, satu charge, satu charge.
Saya rasa setiap satu tu satu charge, madam.
Okay. Why?
Sebab macam tak adil lah kalau orang tu buat banyak kali tapi satu
okay. Tapi madam right. kalau lah pukul 8, contohnya kan element rape kan penetration kan.
Betul.
So let's say pukul 8 ada penetration tapi pukul 12 betul. Tak ada pun. Pukul 3 ada balik penetration. So kenapa nak kena combine? Kena salah satu lah. Pendapat saya madam.
Okay.
Itu you penetration bukan tak dikira rape.
Sorry? Kejap. Boleh sorang-sorang cakap dulu. Faiz. Muhammad Faiz. Ha.
Madam, saya setuju dengan separate charge.
Separate charge, maknanya tiga lah. Tiga.
Yes.
Kenapa
yes.
kenapa you setuju? I mean, once you agree, you have to give the reason why.
Oh, let's say if sebab separate charge tu kan, benda mm-hmm. tu kalau combine, dia jadi mm-hmm. macam satu je lah kesalahan dia. Kan dia buat, walaupun benda tu sama, rape je, tapi waktu berbeza. Banyak kali mm-hmm. dia commit. So, mm-hmm. hukumannya patut lebih berat lah.
Mm-hmm.
Oh, macam tu saya faham madam.
Okay, siapa tadi nak cakap? Wafi eh? Siapa tadi? Okay. Ada tapi pendapat madam. Lain?
Madam.
Ya. Yeah.
Walaupun contohlah kali kedua yang kedua punya rogol tu tak berlaku penetration.
Mm-hmm.
Tapi andai kata dia dalam satu pertuduhan, dia mm-hmm. dikira dia masih dikira rogol sama ada kali pertama atau kali pertama berlaku penetration, mm-hmm. kali kedua tak berlaku mm-hmm. penetration, kali mm-hmm. ketiga mungkin berlaku.
Mm-hmm.
Tapi better ada satu charge sebab hukuman mungkin berbeza.
Hukuman mungkin berbeza? Maksud you?
Seandainya charge jatuh,
aha.
hukuman yang dijatuhkan kepada pesalah mungkin berbeza. Mengikut, mungkin kita boleh beratkan yang okay, dia berlaku tiga kali rogol.
Aha.
Macam tu lah pada pendapat saya. Kalau okay. nak separate charge,
uh-huh.
takkan macam mana tiba charge pertama contohlah sikit dia punya jatuh ke hukuman tu.
Uh-huh.
Kali tiga tu lain pula dia punya tu.
So kalau macam tu, okay. Macam you, tadi Wan Suhaili cakap, okay. Dia elements of part of the element is to penetration kan? Alright. So, sekarang ni dalam satu pertuduhan, maknanya kena buktikanlah berlaku penetration pada ketiga-tiga masa yang dinyatakan, betul tak? Betul kan? Betul, so kalau betul. Macam Wan Suhaili kata tadi, tak boleh sebab nanti kata tiba-tiba tak, second katalah yang kali kedua tu tak terbukti pula penetration dia. So macam mana nak proof charge? Macam mana?
Madam. Kalau saya nak quote section 153 boleh, madam?
Section 153. Aha. You nak impose section 153, okay.
Tentang apa detail time, place, pada, and person, okay. Pada masa, tempat dan orang.
Aha. Memang boleh sebab dalam okay, chat mesti ada.
Jadi dekat section 1531.
1531, okay. Uh-huh. Okay. The charge shall contain such particulars as to the time and place.
Jadi sebabkan dekat dalam charge tu kita ada.
Memang tulis. Betul. Tapi bila kali
ini sebabkan fakta itu berlaku pada orang yang sama, cuma masa yang berbeza, tapi kesalahan yang sama. Sebab
kesalahan yang sama, betul lah. Betul lah, memang kesalahan yang sama, orang yang sama, mangsa yang sama. Cuma waktu je yang berbeza.
Ya, sebab tu kita gabungkan. Saya nak kata seksyen 153 ni membenarkan lah. Gabungkan ketiga-tiga apa kesalahan rate pada tiga masa yang berbeza itu dalam satu pertuduhan.
Tapi bukan ke particulars 153 ni we're talking about actually particular apa? Particulars apa ni? Maklumat. Maklumat berkaitan dengan masa, tempat dan orang lah yang berkaitan. Itu je itu sebenarnya apa yang dimaksudkan dengan 153. So macam mana kita nak kata by 153 kita boleh combine the time. Dia cuma cakap for a chart setiap pertuduhan mesti ada masa. Mesti ada tempat, mesti ada orang lah. I mean, orang yang terlibat lah. Itu je dia cakap. So macam mana kita nak kata yang by way of 153, kita boleh combine tiga-tiga masa tu.
Madam, saya nak cuba boleh?
Boleh. Sila.
Saya salah lah.
Kalau section 166.
Sila.
Kalau kita guna section 166, madam.
166. Okay. What about section 166?
Bila kita macam Suhaili cakap, bila that charge kita tak tahu yang mana satu ada penetration or not, we can use this section.
Section 166 ni about alternative charge. When you are in doubt, you can prefer in the alternative kan?
Yes.
Contohlah macam ni. Sebab dalam case yang the case that we are talking about now is actually macam saya cakap, it's a case of rape, right? DPP dah tengok, dia kata okay, ada medical report mengatakan berlaku ada hymen tear, contohnya new hymen tear. So basically would suggest would suggest ada kemasukan, ya? Alright, so katalah you tak ada issue on whether there's doubt ataupun tak pasti ke kan? Katalah this clear. Tapi tiga kali berlakunya perbuatan tu. Perbuatan rogol tu. Orang yang sama, victim yang sama.
Madam.
Ya. Yeah.
Saya nak cuba.
Sila, tak apa. Silakan.
Saya rasa bawah section 164.
Ya. Yeah.
Sebab kita boleh try dalam satu offense, sebab dalam section yang satu nampak dikata bila only one accused and bila more than one offense, the offense are of the same kind, the offense are committed within 12 months, the victims may be the same or not, and the number of charges joined must not exceed 3 charges.
Okay, alright. Betul. Offense of same kind. Memang boleh, tak ada masalah. Kita memang boleh charge together kan? I mean charge jointly. Cuma yang my question was that dalam kes ni, adakah kita akan charge for different charges? Maknanya kita akan charge for 3 separate rate charge ataupun kita just charge satu rate charge tapi kita put there pada pukul 3, pada pukul 6 dan pada pukul 9 telah merogol siapa. Betul. Kalau you buat separately, memang boleh charge. Tak? Boleh didengar bersama. Tak ada masalah. Ada lagi yang nak cuba?
Saya nak cuba boleh
ke? Ya, sila.
Sorry, tadi ada...
Kuat sikit tapi saya tak apa-apa dengar.
Separate charge.
silakan tadi tu. Saya cakap saya cuba selepas. Sebab tadi saya dah cuba. Siapa tadi nak cuba?
Separate charge, madam.
Separate charge, okay. Separate charge kerana apa?
Dalam 163 cakap, separate charge for distinct offences.
Kenapa you kata offenses. Dia, sebab dia kata ni distinct offences. Adakah perbuatan yang pukul 3, pukul 6, pukul 8 tu semua adalah distinct offences?
Pada pendapat saya, walaupun dia rape, saya memetik kata-kata Wafi, perbuatan dia berbeza-beza.
Lepas perbuatan dia berbeza-beza, okay.
Bagi saya, dia bukan continuing offences. So, dia rape, lepas tu rehat jap, petang rape lagi, lepas tu buat lagi malam. So, dia bukan satu perbuatan yang berterusan dan juga satu sahaja. Dia adalah tiga benda yang berbeza.
Okay, rape, alright. Rape. Okay, you were saying like macam pagi, petang, malam. Katalah 1 hour apart. Contohnya pukul 3. Lepas tu pukul 4 dia rate lagi. Pukul 5 dia rate lagi. Contohnya lah 1 hour apart. Itu continuing ke bukan?
Bukan.
Bukan juga? Why?
Macam mana madam? Boleh ulang balik tak? Okay. Saya bukan-bukan, saya tak dengar.
Okay. Contohnya macam tadi you cakap the rape occurs contoh pagi, lepas tu then petang, lepas tu malam kan? Okay. Itu you kata bukan continuing. So dia distinct. Okay. Tu nampaklah macam sebab jauh kan? So tapi katalah the rape occurs pukul 3 pagi, pukul 4 pagi, pukul 5 pagi. It's just 1 hour apart. Is that continuing ke tak? Is that distinct ke tidak?
Saya rasa tidak. Sebab 3, 4, 5.
Mungkin
sebelum 4 tu dah habis dah. Lepas tu 4 buat lagi. Lepas tu sebelum 5 dah berhenti. Lepas tu 5 buat lagi. So dia adalah distinct offences.
Distinct offences. Regardless of
sebab
the
saya macam pernah tengok dekat berita dulu kan. Ada. Saya pernah tengok kat berita dulu. Saya tak tahu saya silap ke tak. Tapi ada yang bapak rogol anak dia tu. Dia bukan, dia rogol banyak kali. Tapi dia tak jatuh one offences dia. Dia kena semua tuduhan.
Yang berapa puluh tu ya? 90 berapa charge tu? Semua orang tahu tu. Yang dekat Syah Alam
so
tu kan?
So fahaman saya macam tu lah.
I see. Okay, tadi saya nampak Wan Suhaili was about to say something. Were you?
Oh, saya cuma bersetuju dengan Syauki. Lepas tu, madam, bagi saya, kalau buat asing charge tu, dia memberi peluang kepada defendant untuk mengurangkan charge. Let's say, rogol yang kali kedua tu tak ada rogol. So, boleh jadi sexual respon je. I mean, tu macam lagi fair dan justice lah benda tu.
Okay. Okay. Alright. Since everybody...
Saya pun setuju dengan apa idea Syauki dengan Suhaili tu. Okay. Sebab kalau kita buat separate ataupun pertuduhan yang berbeza, boleh bincangkan satu khusus dan mendalam lah.
Okay. Okay. Why I ask? Because rape ni biasa berlaku dalam keadaan mangsa adalah sama. Accused pun orang yang sama. Alright. Good observation, Boy Syauki. Kau kata kes yang bapak rogol anak yang 90 over charges dekat Shah Alam tu, yang which took berapa hari kalau tak silap saya 3 hari kot nak baca charge je, nak baca pertuduhan sahaja 3 hari kalau saya tak silap lah. Okay. Untuk pertuduhan bagi rape atau rogol, setiap satu perbuatan, okay, walaupun 5 minit apart, katalah satu mula dia rogol perempuan ni pukul 3. Ataupun lepas tu 3-10 minit dia rogol lagi. Okay. 3-20 dia rogol lagi. Walaupun it like 20 minutes apart. But setiap satu perbuatan rogol, berlakunya kemasukan zakat lelaki ke dalam kemaluan wanita, setiap tanpa konsen wanita tersebut, contohlah tanpa konsen wanita tersebut, is one offense. Okay. So bila one offense, it's a separate offense. They're distinct from each other. Walaupun terhadap mangsa yang sama, walaupun by the same perpetrator. Okay. So basically, you have to charge him 3 kali kalau macam dalam keadaan tadi. 3 charge. 3 pertuduhan yang berbeza. Okay. Of course, let's set aside being fair or not fair. One of the reason is macam Suhaili cakap, kemungkinan sebab elements dia semua, dia, you have to prove for each one, you have to prove all the elements. Okay, you have to prove each one, each of the if each of the charge dia punya element. Kalau satu yang pukul 6, contoh yang the middle one, the second one tu, pukul 6 tu tak dapat buktikan penetration. So, it either discharge the person atau the court may reduce the charge to one of outraging modesty sahaja. Okay. But the main reason was because it is distinct offences. Dia memang berbeza walaupun terhadap offence tu sama. Okay. Same kind. Same. Yang ni memang betul lah same kind lah. Merogol. Mangsa pun sama. Perpetrator pun sama. Tapi perbuatan tu berbeza bagi setiap satu. Okay. So kalau kita charge satu pertuduhan dengan tiga masa yang berbeza, if one cannot be proved, the whole charge tu tak boleh dibuktikan. Sebab satu charge means you have to prove everything dalam charge tu. So one falls down, everything falls down. Okay. Plus because rape, setiap perbuatan adalah satu perbuatan, satu offence. Okay, eh? Okay. Okay. Faham, eh? So kena tengok. We don't know when it will become one offence, distinct offences atau tidak. Okay?
Madam, saya ada soalan.
Belum. Ya, silakan.
Okay, macam madam kata, okay, saya dah setuju dengan idea madam. Lepas tu saya, tapi saya cuma nak tahu dengan lebih jelas lah.
Yeah.
Kalau ada apa panggil jarak masa pun kan.
Mm-hmm. Betul.
Dikira offence yang berbeza.
Mm-hmm.
Okay, yang pertama, kalau dalam kes rogol, jarak masa tu kita nak kira macam mana, atau dia ada guideline ke ataupun tak dia ada. Bergantung kepada question of facts.
Tak ada.
Yang kedua, macam mana nak kira rogol tu kan kemasukan.
Kemasukan. You terputus ke atau you punya apa ni tak dengar? Okay, tak apa. Wafi tanya pasal masa kan? Tak ada spesifik, right? Apa yang you kena tengok adalah elements, right? Contohnya, rape punya elements adalah first berlakunya sexual intercourse, eh? Sexual intercourse antara seorang lelaki dengan seorang wanita, eh? So sexual intercourse. Sexual intercourse means what? Okay, right? Berlakunya penetration, kemasukan, okay? And then consent. Kalau let's take an adult lah, ya, consent. So dia tidak memberikan tidak consent. The victim tak consent. Eh. So regardless of what the time when it happens, as long as setiap kali perbuatan tu boleh dibuktikan ke semua elemen. Faham tak? Eh? Selagi setiap elemen pertuduhan rogol tu boleh dibuktikan bagi setiap satu perbuatan, then it will be a charge, one charge. One for each perbuatan. Tak kira lah within a span of what? 10 minutes, 20 minutes. Okay? Right? Okay. Second, tadi Wafi tanya second one apa? Lupa dah saya. Wafi boleh ulang tak yang soalan kedua?
Soalan kedua, macam mana rogol tu dikira satu kali rogol?
Satu kali sebab, rogol, okay.
Sebab dia kata kemasukan tapi dia tak cakap berapa kali kemasukan. Itu yang saya nak tahu. Contohnya dalam, madam faham kan soalan saya kan?
Faham. Okay, alright. Okay. Bila berlakunya perlakuan rogol ni adalah apabila berlakunya kemasukan. Alright? Okay. Semua belum kahwin kan? Kalau saya bercakap dengan orang yang dah berkahwin senang. Okay, dia orang dah faham. Okay, tapi maksudnya adalah berlakunya kemasukan zakar lelaki ke dalam kemaluan perempuan setiap kali berlakunya perbuatan kemasukan. So, macam mana saya nak explain? Okay, sexual intercourse ni.
Madam, kalau terkeluar dia sekali, kalau terkeluar, tentu kali kedua.
Dia macam ni, okay. Dia macam ni, okay. Hubungan seksual ni dia macam ni, alright. Dia ada, macam mana nak kata ya. Dia ada pergerakan. Alright. Dia ada pergerakan. Okay. Kalau, kalau perbuatan tu is actually a one, it's a one dalam situasi yang sama. Alright. Because when you do sexual intercourse, there will be movements. Alright. Movements of both of the body. Almost certain there will be movements of the body. Alright. Dan zakar lelaki akan masuk ke dalam kemaluan wanita dan hanya akan dilepaskan atau dikeluarkan once he has ejaculated ataupun kadang-kadang dia akan keluarkan sebelum he ejaculated. Okay. So, kita akan ambil keadaan whereby, okay, because kita tak boleh nak, kita tak tanya secara detail sampai okay, berapa kali dia masukkan. Kadang-kadang budak perempuan tu pun tak boleh nak fikir pun. Dia cuma tahu lelaki tu masukkan kemaluan dia ke dalam, masukkan zakar dia ke dalam kemaluan dia. Okay. So, what we normally do is that in the event that, okay, he inserted his penis inside the girl's vagina, okay, and he do whatever movement sampai he ejaculated, or even if he did not ejaculate until he stop. Okay. Ada orang dia tak mampu untuk ejaculate. Ada lelaki yang tidak mampu untuk ejaculate. Ejaculate bahasa apa dan Melayu saya pun tak tahulah. But ada lelaki yang tak mampu untuk ejaculate. Dia cuma boleh erect and then dia will die off. Ada keadaan macam tu. Okay. Gelak Syami. Tapi it happens ya. Yeah? But it happens. Saya tahu ramai yang gelak kat belakang tu tapi sebab tak nampak muka. But it happens. Ada keadaan yang macam tu. It die off. Tapi as the elements of the church tak semestinya mengatakan you have to ejaculate ke, mesti you die off ke tak. As long as berlaku je kemasukan. Okay? Bila ada je berlaku kemasukan, kita consider it as rape. Okay? So normally what we charge is that apabila tamatnya satu perlakuan, maknanya even if that died off ke ejaculate, itu kira anggap kita anggap satu lah. Satu tuduhan sebab satu, kita nak proof berapa kali dia keluar masuk tu pun, belum tentu kita boleh dapat daripada victim. Victim pun mungkin tak ingat berapa kali. Okay, so we calculate that as one. Tapi later on, katalah 30 minutes later, 1 hour later lah. Okay, kalau 30 minutes later tu terror jugalah orang lelaki tu kan. Katalah 1 hour later. Okay, dia rape lagi. That is will be another set of perbuatan. Okay? Okay. Boleh tak? Faham tak?
Faham, madam. Tapi tadi madam ada cakap pasal dia kira kemasukan sahajalah.
Betul. Dia berhenti kira, tu, yeah,
dia berhenti tu madam kata apa, kira pada pergerakan.
Okay. Bukan. Maksudnya macam ni, dia tidak kira berapa kali pergerakan basically. Tapi memanglah bila berlakunya sexual intercourse akan berlaku pergerakan. In and out. Okay, macam dia cakap, kalau dia keluarkan macam mana? Kan? So kita biasanya akan charge macam ni. Surrounding the one particular event. Okay, katalah pukul 3 tu, dia rape the girl for about 10 minutes. 10 minutes in the sense that berlaku pergerakan lah, berlaku whatever lah. Sampai mungkin dia die off ataupun sampai mungkin dia lelaki tu ejaculate. Maknanya dia mengeluarkan air mani dia. Right? Walaupun dengan mengeluarkan air mani tu doesn't prove anything. Right? Okay? Yang penting adalah perempuan tu boleh katakan bahawa perpetrator tu boleh, telah memasukkan kemaluan zakarnya ke dalam kemaluan dia. Itu je. Right? Okay. Itu dah satu offense. Right? And then lepas tu, after 10 minutes, the sexual intercourse happen. And then, of course, sexual intercourse, bila berlakunya perhubungan seksual, especially for the guy, they need a break. Okay, they need a break. Alright? Dia tak boleh terus apa melakukan hubungan seksual terus-terus. Okay, after once ejaculate, okay, buat lagi. No, that's not, itu bukan fitrah. Okay. So they need a break. Normally it will take about more than an hour. Okay. Saya tak tahulah kalau orang yang ambil Viagra tu, saya tak tahulah. Tapi normally it will take about more than an hour kalau orang ni. So let's just say another hour, dia rape lagi perempuan tu. So after that 1 hour dia, masukkan lagi kemaluan dia ke dalam kemaluan wanita tu, that's another offense of rape. Okay. Kita tak ambil setiap kali dia keluar masuk tu, tak. Okay. Kita ambil for that one particular event, berapa kali, satu sebagai satu offense. Okay. Sebagai satu offense of rape. Okay, boleh? Mana Wafi? Saya tak nampak dah.
Boleh madam, saya faham.
Okay, faham kan? Cuma, dah zaman sekarang ni faham semua.
Satu lagi lah saya nak tanya.
Ya, boleh.
Silakan. Andainya, jikalau tak mengeluarkan tapi dia ambil break, contohnya dia angkat telefon ke apa, dia tak keluarkan. Tapi dia ambil break. Dia kira dua offense tak?
Tak.
Satu lagi sebab benda, sebab dia masih tak dibuat penubukan kali kedua .
Susah sikit lah kita nak cakap. Tapi selalunya, even if dia take a break for taking a phone call, tapi dia masih lagi dalam keadaan apa, perhubungan seksual yang sama tu, we can still consider that as one. Selalunya yang kita buat separately ni, macam yang tadi saya cakap lah, okay, dia dah rape perempuan tu, dia dah had sexual intercourse dengan perempuan tu, dia tak kira lah, in between tu dia ada menjawab panggilan telefon ke apa, and then 10 or 15 minutes later, dia ejaculate ke tak ejaculate, doesn't matter lah, let's say dia ejaculate. Lepas tu dia relax, dia keluar, dia pergi makan, and then dia datang balik, dah minum air apa semua, dia datang balik dengan perempuan tu, dia rape lagi sekali. Dia buat sexual intercourse lagi, macam tu lah selalunya kita akan judge.
Kiranya madam, satu sesi tu satu perlakuan lah.
Satu sesi tu, lebih kurang macam tu. Satu sesi tu satu perlakuan.
Okay madam, terima kasih.
Okay, sama. Alright. Okay ya? Okay. Faham ya? Alright. Okay. Rape ni memang kadang-kadang sebab dulu keadaan yang sama juga. Masa saya ajar magistrate lah. Dia kata, kenapa kita tak cat sekali je? Kata, tak ialah magistrate baru lah. So dia tanya. No, because it's distinct offence. Sebab setiap satu perbuatan tu dianggap satu offence. So bila satu offence, it's a separate charge. Okay? Okay ya? Okay ya semua? Alright. Okay. Kalau bercakap macam ni, betul-betul semua boleh lah dengar. Kalau tidak, nanti kan semua tidur. Saya bagi lecture je. Betul tak? Okay, alright. Ada apa-apa soalan lagi? Okay? I won't go into that with regards to charges, because you pun dah belajar, but you have to understand. Contohnya macam tadi 153 ya, 153 is actually talking about the particulars of a charge. Maksudnya apa yang perlu ada dalam pertuduhan? Perlu ada dalam pertuduhan adalah masa, tempat, and person, orang yang terlibat. Contohnya kalau acute, kalau ada mangsa, kena sebut nama mangsa, berapa umurnya. Contohnya elements of statutory rape. Elements of statutory rape, you kena mention umur mangsa dalam charge. Okay, kita kadang-kadang kita siap letak kat situ, Ayu bin Ali, nombor kad pengenalan berapa, lepas tu berumur berapa tahun, berumur 14 tahun contoh, kita tulis dalam charge. Okay, why? Because age is a factor untuk case rape, statutory rape. Okay, time, place. Okay. Pernah tak dengar, katalah saksi tu tak ingat pukul berapa berlakunya kejadian. Contohnya kejadian bunuh. Alright? Kejadian bunuh kadang-kadang tak ada saksi kan? Tak ada saksi. So macam mana kita nak tahu orang tu mati pukul berapa?
Pakai
forensik.
Pakai apa tadi? Nurul Hasanah? Pakai apa tadi?
Pakai expert opinion macam doktor lah, forensik tu.
Forensik, okay, alright. Okay, so pakai forensik dia akan cakap apa selalunya?
Mangsa dibunuh lebih kurang pada waktu.
Pada waktu, okay. So kalau dalam pertuduhan tu kita akan ikut waktu macam mana? Kita nak letak, pukul, kita nak letak macam mana? Kalau dalam tuduhan tu kita akan letak macam mana?
Pada waktu kejadian.
Ah, pada waktu kejadian. Ah, waktu dia tu macam mana kita nak letak?
Sebab dia kira-kira. Ha. Dia ada tulis kira-kira pukul jam bla bla bla.
Okey. Alright.
Maksudnya perlu detail jam berapa perkara tu dia lakukan lah.
Detail tu maksudnya macam mana? Okey. Kalau detail tu maksudnya macam mana?
Sekejap, setakat yang saya faham kira-kira jam kalau tak boleh nak spesifik, kira-kira antara jam 2 sehingga 3 petang.
Okay, alright. Betul. Okay, betul lah basically. Kalau tak boleh spesifik, tak boleh spesifik pukul berapa, okay. Antara lah. Okay, macam murder ni selalunya forensik lah. Dia akan cakap si mati, katalah dia dijumpai let's say pukul 8 malam. Mayat dia dijumpai pukul 8 malam. Forensik buat postmortem dalam pukul 10 malam. So, after the postmortem, forensic kata the deceased died about 6 hours before. Contoh. So, daripada pukul 10 malam tu tolak lah. So, they estimated about pukul 4 lah lebih kurang antara pukul 4 pukul apa. And of course, lain daripada tu kita kena tengok juga kalau ada keterangan-keterangan lain. Mungkin kadang-kadang circumstantial evidence yang lain. The last person who saw him ke, atau ada orang nampak dia ke, atau benda macam tu lah. So that's where we determine what time. Okay, antara pukul berapa.
Madam, yeah. Kalau macam mayat tu macam biasanya dah 3 bulan mati ke, kalau macam tu?
Kalau mayat dah berbulan-bulan kan, tiba-tiba jumpa. Macam mana tu?
Tarikh je kot beda pula yang tu.
Okay. Tarikh tu maksudnya apa?
Bulan dibunuh, maybe September ke. Dia tak mention time sebab tak boleh nak mention.
Betul. True, betul. Kalau ada kematian contohnya dah berbulan-bulan dah, ada ataupun setahun pun ada. Kadang kan? Kita tak tahu bulan berapa hari apa exactly dia mati. Kita tak boleh nak tahu pun. Sebab kadang-kadang jumpa tulang aja kan. Mana nak tahu? So what you do, you still have to go through all the investigation. Then from there, kita boleh narrow down. More often than not, we might be able to narrow down when is the most likelihood, the month or the year that he was murdered, contohnya. More often than not, kalau orang mati ni, akan ada laporan mengatakan dia hilang. Kan? Somebody will go buat report, saya dapati anak saya tak balik-balik, contohnya lah. So from that, maknanya from that report, it means that daripada tarikh report tu dah ada possibility lah, start from the date of the report made. Most likely, selepas daripada tu lah ataupun from the date of the report lah. Okay, tapi kalau tak tahu juga, we normally ask the victim, kalau murder tak ada victim lah, sebab murder dia dah mati kan. We normally look at the whole circumstances. We do. Sometimes ada keadaan memang kita letak juga antara tahun berapa hingga tahun berapa, sebab kita memang tak tahu, tak dapat jumpa. Tapi kalau macam tu, bila the span of time is too long, tak sesuai juga, sebab bila span of time terlalu jauh, defense of alibi can be used. Okay? The victim, the accused boleh gunakan macam-macam, tak kata. Within a span of 1 year, how do you know? Kan, 1 tahun, mana boleh, kan? Takkan pertuduhan, normally it's within months. Contohnya dalam bulan, we will try to narrow down. Prosecution as best possible akan try to narrow down, even to the month. Okay? Even dalam macam case rate pun ada juga yang dia tak boleh ingat tarikh. Okay? Dia cakap, saya ingat masa bulan Ogos tahun lepas sebab ataupun dia kata bulan September tahun lepas sebab one or two weeks before that merdeka. So maknanya kalau few weeks before that merdeka, it will be September lah, tapi tak tahu berapa bulan, dia tak boleh nak letak pun, dia pun tak ingat. So we just put that dalam bulan September. That's the nearest that we can. Okay, tapi sebaik-baiknya adalah if we narrow down, if we can to narrow down the date. Sebaik-baik mungkin bolehlah. Selalu kalau kita jumpa witness, kita kata, cuba ingat minggu pertama ke, minggu kedua ke, atau macam mana pun. Yeah? Sebab bila terlalu, contohnya dia kata dalam bulan September, bila? Yeah? The defense pun akan jadi, akan start to argue that the charge is vexatious. Okay? Vexatious. Vague. Yeah? Bulan September tu ada 30 hari. 30 hari saya berada di merata-rata. Saya ada di luar negara, saya ada di mana-mana kan. So if it's not specific macam tu, dia kata macam mana dia nak bagi apa ni defense. Contohnya dia kata dia nak gunakan defense of alibi. Sebab saya bulan September most of the time saya kat overseas, contohnya lah. So dia akan they can always argue that the charges are vague. Okay, tapi kadang-kadang memang kita tak dapat nak pinpoint. We try our best lah. But the best is to get a pinpoint date. Okay. Okay. Alright. Time tu doesn't mean mesti ada. Okay. Pada 1 Februari 2020 pukul berapa? Tak semestinya. Kadang-kadang tarikh sahaja. Okay. Tarikh sahaja pun boleh. Yeah. Bila tanya masa memang saya tak ingat. Tapi sebelah malam contohnya kan. Ataupun bila tanya masa saya tak ingat pukul apa, tapi saya rasa dah tengah hari sebab matahari dah terang, contohlah. So kita tak boleh letaklah, kita just letak tarikh. So bila masa dia bagi evidence, dia boleh cakap secara spesifik pukul berapa, tapi pukul berapa dia tak tahu. Okay ya? Boleh? Okay ya? Okay ya? Tak ada apa? Okay, tak apa nanti sebab Datuk punya assignment to you is for you to dig up further kan? Tak apa. Nanti hari Isnin, saya akan bagi assignment. A simple one. About charges. And hari Jumaat. Jumaat, since next week saya plan on doing both 2 days. Jumaat. We will discuss on that. Yeah? On the charges. Boleh saya tanya tak? Boleh saya tahu tak? You off ni satu batch sekarang ada berapa orang ya?
93.
Berapa?
93.
93 ya? Oh, okay. Last time it was 96.
Yes, 96.
Oh, okay. 3 orang tak ada lah. Ya? Yeah. Okay. So, 93 ya? Alright. Okay. Okay ya? Alright. So, that's basically benda-benda yang kita selalu came across with regards to charges. Eh? Joint trial ke, joint charges ke, satu charge ke, tidak ke, benda-benda macam tu. Right? Ni kalau commercial crime offences, the details apa yang nak kena letak. Okay? Memang charge ni memang complicated sikit. Okay? Unless you practice, you buat benda tu, jadi DPP contohnya, you prepare the charge yourself, you tengok dah apa yang you kena buat, then baru you can grab apa yang perlu ada. Okay. Alright. That's relatively about charge. Okay. Kalau tak ada apa-apa soalan, saya rasa saya proceed for 51A dulu. Why 51A is important? Because untuk for purposes of mock trial, for purposes of actual trial pun, memang you kena deliver documents. Yeah? Dalam kes-kes jenayah, for the prosecutor to deliver a copy of the documents to be tendered in court to the adverse party, to the defense counsel. Okay. Right, so yang ni saya share sikit lah ya. But it's a short one ya. Yeah? Alright, okay. Section 51A, ya. Yeah? Okay, 51A, delivery of documents. Okay. This one is just an explanation, okay. Section 51A ni dulu tak wujud, ya. Yeah? Way back before 2007, dia tak wujud. Right. sebelum ni tidak ada keperluan untuk kita kemukakan kepada pihak satu lagi apa-apa dokumen yang perlu digunakan, that we have to use to submit in court. We do not have to deliver anything. We do not have to deliver anything to the other party. So dulu, back then, cases for criminal cases, what the defense normally call it as a case of surprise. Basically, nothing was given to them except for, nothing was given to the defense counsel except for the accused caution statement and also the charge. Okay, zaman tu before the introduction of section 51A, before the introduction of 51A, only two documents je given to the defense counsel. Yang lain tak ada. Okay, alright. So with the introduction of section 51A, in 2007, the prosecution is now has a duty to deliver a copy of the documents to be submitted or to be tendered in court to the defense counsel. So basically with this introduction of this provision, it means that there's no more surprise lah. So the defense now will actually know what are the documents to be tendered in court by the prosecution. Okay. And then section 151A ni came into force in 2007. There was an amendment in 2012. Before that, there were only two sections. In 2012, they amended and include three more subsections. Okay. And that one came into force on the 1st of June 2012, right? All right. Okay, prior to the amendments in 2012, effect of non-compliance to section 51A. So basically, 51A kata you have to submit whatever the documents that you wanted to tender in court to the defense counsel prior to the commencement of the trial. Prior to the commencement of the trial means what? Prior to the sebelum perbicaraan bermula. Perbicaraan, do you all remember apa maksud perbicaraan masa saya? First, Lulu came and give you all a lecture, Lulu. What does trial mean? When does the trial begin? When does the trial begin?
Panggil witness.
When you start calling your first witness, that's when the trial begins. Huh? So, by virtue of this provision, section 51A, it states that you have to submit all those documents to the defense counsel sebelum you call your first witness, okay? Alright. But before that, tidak ada peruntukan yang mengatakan tidak ada provision subsection 3. The existing subsection 3 tak ada. Before 2012 amendment. Subsection 3 does not exist. Okay. So, what happens? What happens when non-compliant happen? Maknanya DPP tak submit the documents before the trial. Okay. Early on, Muhammad Fazil Awaluddin, the court decided that non-compliance did not make a trial a nullity. We mean that it's only procedural. Section 51A is only procedural, not evidential. So non-compliance would not statutorily bar the prosecution from tendering documents which were not delivered to the accused before trial as evidence at the trial. Meaning that kalau tak submit pun masih boleh submit masa balik admit the document semasa perbicaraan. Eh? The word shall means the provision is directory and not mandatory. This was before the 2012 amendment, right? Okay. Right. However, dalam tahun 2010, Datuk Syed Anwar Ibrahim case-nya cakap compliance to section 51A is obligatory or mandatory in nature. So masa this all happens before the amendment. Okay, dia dah jadi terbalik. Okay. So bila mandatory, you kena comply with lah. Prior to trial kena bagi. Alright. Okay. However, Amendment 2012 was made. The purpose was to make it clear that documents to be tendered by the prosecution under subsection 51A, subsection 1 are admissible in evidence notwithstanding that the prosecution did not deliver the documents to the accused. This was the reason amendments was made. And by virtue of subsection 3, non-compliance to subsection 1, that you must deliver the documents, does not make the evidence inadmissible. Okay. Right? But at the same time, subsection 4 was also added. However, the court may exclude document delivered after commencement of trial if shown delivery done deliberately and in bad faith. Okay. Kalau you, the prosecution failed to deliver the document before the commencement of the trial, and it is shown that the failure to deliver the document was done deliberately and in bad faith, dengan niat jahat. Okay. So, kalau mahkamah dapati bahawa dokumen itu tidak diserahkan, was not submitted, was not to the defense, and it was done in that bad faith, mahkamah boleh menolak kemasukan dokumen tersebut semasa perbicaraan. Subsection 5, document delivered after commencement of trial, the court shall allow accused. Okay, in the case where the court allowed documents to be submitted after commencement of a trial, however, the court shall allow the accused reasonable time to examine the document and recall or resummon and examine any witnesses in relation to the document. Right? Okay, so that is basically 3452 are basically the new provisions after amendment in 2012. Okay, so basically itu 51A itu je. The thing is, yang penting ni adalah you have to deliver a document that you are tendering in court to the other party prior to the trial. Okay, plus you also have under subsection under the same provision, section 51A subsection 1C pula, a written statement of fact favorable to the defense. Selain daripada kita kena submit a a copy of the documents to be tendered in court to the other party, we also have to submit a written statement of facts, a written statement of facts favorable to the defense. Okay, maknanya kalau ada fakta yang favorable to the defense, okay, you have to prepare submit to the other party juga. Right? Apa contoh facts favorable to the defense?
Contohnya fakta yang kes rogol kat situ bukan pelakunya bukan perogol itu bukan seorang tapi lebih daripada seorang yang mana mungkinlah bukan yang defense lah, yang boleh jadi bukanlah perogol sebenar. Ha, itu pun.
Probably kalau ada keterangan macam tu, boleh. Apa-apa keterangan yang boleh membantu pembelaan, basically. Contohnya macam dulu, I had a case yang, case drugs, okay? Case dadah. Ikut keterangan based on the witnesses, police witnesses punya statement, they went to the shop, okay, they went to the shop, they saw this accused duduk dekat meja dekat kedai makan holding a bag, bawa bag, okay. So and dia kata dalam kenyataan polis kata tak ada orang lain, accused orang. So masa dia jumpa, dia tangkap accused was holding the bag. But then, there was also a statement by the restaurant owner. Restaurant owner tu cakap apa? Restaurant owner tu kata semasa kejadian, dia ada di cashier. Dan meja accused adalah about 2 tables away from the cashier. So he saw everything. So dia kata, masa OKT ditangkap, ada 2 orang. Ada seorang lain bersama OKT pada ketika itu. That fact is actually favorable to the accused. So fakta tu kita tak boleh tidak maklumkan. Maknanya ada keterangan saksi menunjukkan bahawa sebenarnya ada orang lain dekat meja tu. But what whatever the other person is there for, kita tak tahulah. Tapi sebab restaurant owner is a public public witness, saksi awam. So basically keterangan dia mengatakan bahawa ada orang lain sebenarnya, sedangkan keterangan polis saying otherwise. But that fact is actually favourable to the accused, which as prosecution you kena highlight. Okay, so apa-apa fakta yang statement of facts which is favourable to the accused under section 51A, you have to inform. You kena bagi tahu. Inform dalam, biasanya dalam bentuk surat lah kita letak. But normally kalau tak ada, we just say written statement of fact. There are no statement of fact. There are no facts favourable to the accused. Kalau for prosecution kata tak ada apa-apa, then we just put no. Tiada. Okay. So basically itu section 51A. Section 51A ni nampak simple, tapi ramai yang kadang-kadang confused ataupun dia orang tak buat. Alasan sebab dia orang tak apa ni, tak sempat, ataupun atas alasan it's no longer mandatory. Tapi tak boleh. The fact that the law says that you have to submit, you have to admit. Just because you tak submit, you have to show that you did not do it in bad faith. Atau okay, katalah, kata saya saja malas nak bagi. Is that bad faith?
Yes.
Sebab the law says that subsection 4 kata such delivery was so done deliberately. Dengan sengaja. Maknanya dia sengaja tak nak bagi. Dia kata-kata saya malas nak bagi. Contohlah kan. Dia kata saya malas nak bagi. Dia kata I can always use subsection 3. Then that is deliberately. Dia memang you tak nak bagilah kan. You deliberately do not want to give. Whether you have bad faith, probably most likely memang you ada bad faith lah. Kan? So kalau you then when you fail, then those documents tak boleh dikemukakan di mahkamah. Bila dokumen-dokumen yang, when documents that you are supposed to tender, you are supposed to prove in court are not able to be admitted because of failure to comply with section 51A, the effect is that the whole case nanti cannot be proved against the accused. So if you become a prosecutor, don't take this provision lightly. So take it seriously. Memang dia tambah kerja lah sebenarnya, tambah kerja kepada pendakwaan, but the law evolves as time goes by kan. Macam di US, dia complete disclosure. Everything yang the prosecution ada semua will be submitted to the defense. Macam kita at least in Malaysia, the witness statement kita tak bagi. We do not submit the witness statement to the accused on the grounds that witness statements are statements taken during investigation and inadmissible, right? But in the US, everything termasuklah keterangan saksi. Okay? So we move towards delivery of documents, tapi kita tak buatlah secara taklah buat seperti macam mana yang dilakukan di United States lah, di US. US dia memang complete discovery. Okay? Malaysia adalah, but at least there's something. Because as defense counsel, dulu saya prosecutor, now I'm a defense counsel. For a defense counsel, when I got those documents, I tengok, alright, I have to balance juga. At the same time, bila ada documents yang dikemukakan oleh prosecution, we can confront our accused, our client. You kata macam ni, tapi dokumen ni kata otherwise. Okay? So that you can get more truth out of him. Don't worry, but accused selalunya memang akan try to hide somewhere, dia mesti akan cuba juga untuk tutup. Tapi documents normally you cannot see otherwise. No? Kalau ada pun dia kena explain lah. So it's good for both sides actually. It's good for both sides.
Madam, okay. I have question.
Yeah, silakan.
Okay, untuk section 51A, adakah ia hanya terpakai kepada prosecution sahaja ataupun defense bahagian for the defense counsel pun perlu deliver the certain document. Yang kedua tentang application section subsection 3. Kalau defense counsel tak hantar dokumen yang ada pada defense counsel kepada prosecution, adakah dokumen itu juga boleh prosecution argue?
Okay. Kalau you baca section 51A, subsection 1 okay. Dan terus dia cakap, the prosecution shall. This one is specific to the prosecution. Dia terus cakap situ, the prosecution, dia kata, dia tak ada kata parties. Dia kata, the prosecution shall before the commencement of the trial.
Dia memang spesifik dah. Okay.
Yeah, yang ni memang spesifik kepada pendakwaan. So, it doesn't apply to the
defense counsel.
Plus, it cannot apply to defense counsel. One thing, because we are talking about facts favorable to the accused. We're talking also about information made under section 107, which is the FIR, kan?
Yeah, the investigation report.
Yeah, FIR takkan melibatkan defense. So that's why this one is specific to prosecution. So prosecution has to comply with this one. So defense tak perlu.
Thank you.
Tetapi under SPRM Act, right? Di bawah Akta SPRM, Akta Suruhanjaya Pencegahan Rasuah, the similar provision, ada similar provision applies to defense juga. SPRM ni dia specific sikit, ya. Tapi ni specific law. But when we talk about criminal procedure, we always learn, kita belajar general procedure. So general procedure, no. But for SPRM, dia specific. SPRM, dia ada peruntukan yang mengatakan, satu, saya tak ingat berapa section dia. Dia kata, defense has to submit to the other party, to the prosecution, any documents that in support of their defense. Okay. One thing, defense kena submit what are their defense, apa defense dia. Second, also to submit any documents in support of their defense. Nah, itu Akta SPRM. Akta SPRM ni dia lain sikit.
Jadi sebabkan dia atas SPRM adalah akta yang spesifik, dia dia tambah sikitlah prosedur.
Ya, betul. Dia tambah sikit prosedur dia. Okay, tapi that one only applies to SPRM cases lah. Case general yang lain tak.
Masih pakai
CPC.
Okay.
Dia kena tengok the criminal law ni something. One thing, you have to look at the specific law. Kalau specific law ada special provision, you have to follow the specific law, new provision. Tapi kalau tak ada, then you go back to the general provision. Okay. Right. Okay. So faham eh? Section 51A, basically dia applies only to the prosecution. Okay, dia applies to the prosecution and you have to comply with this provision before the commencement of the trial. Okay, ya? Right. Ada soalan? Saya rasa kita boleh tamat dah. Kalau Amlenka ada apa-apa soalan lagi?
Madam.
Ya.
Saya nak tanya yang pada charges tadi. Contohlah kalau kita guna joint charges tu kan. So kita akan dia dijatuhkan kepada satu pertuduhan je. So let's say kalau kita tak boleh buktikan satu pertuduhan tu, jadinya the other pertuduhan yang lain tu akan jatuh gugur juga ke?
Okay, kalau okay. You join charge kalau charge yang sama, you charge different people. Okay? Dua orang lah contoh, kita charge dua orang tapi for the same offense, satu offense yang sama. So kalau fail to prove the charge, so dua-dua akan lepas.
Okay. Okay, thank you madam.
Ada soalan lagi? ada ya. Okay. Ya, kalau tak ada apa soalan, saya rasa kita boleh end kat sini lah ya. Okay, nanti saya akan bagi, I will submit through Syahmi lah. Nanti dia akan forward kepada yang lain tentang little assignment that I need you to do. Next week, I will confirm balik sama ada kelas will be Jumaat dan Sabtu atau Jumaat sahaja. But I will try to make, sebab saya, macam saya cakap 13 tu saya tak ada. Jadi, I might be doing, saya ganti terus lah mungkin minggu depan. Which is on the, berapa bulan ya minggu depan? 6 and 7 of November. So, but at the same time, I will give you that assignment. That assignment is not supposed to be individual. It's supposed to be according to your firm. Okay, satu firm satu. Yeah, boleh ya, macam dululah kan. Walaupun online, you can still communicate with your firm members, right? So satu firm satu. Okay. On Friday, I will pick up at random which firm yang saya nak suruh explain diorang you punya assignment tu. Okay, I will pick up at random and so semua kena ni lah, kena alert lah ya. Lepas tu tapi at the end of that day at the end of Friday, semua kena submit. Yeah? So kita ada berapa firm actually? Syami, kita ada berapa firm semua?
Saya tak ingat total bilangan secara spesifik.
Tapi semualah ya. Saya tak buat individual, saya buat eco firm. So setiap satu firm kena ada satu submission ya. Tapi on Fridays, I will pick and choose which firm yang saya akan minta untuk explain. Mungkin 3 or 4 who will be the lucky ones lah. Okay. Ataupun lebih, tu tengoklah nanti macam mana. Yeah. Okay. So, saya rasa hari ni setakat ni je lah ya. Okay. Pada yang belum makan, go and have your lunch. Siang lah pula. Tak makan lagi sampai pukul 3:45 dah. Okay. So, insyaAllah, we meet again next Friday. Okay. And for those yang di dalam kawasan PKPB, please stay at home. Those outside pun, please lah, everybody please stay safe ya. Yeah? Hopefully, PKPB will be over and we can have our physical class. Okay, for this course. Okay, alright. So, assalamualaikum semua. Terima kasih ya.
Waalaikumsalam.
Thank you, madam.
Madam.
Stay, madam.
Bye.